and this is the TV white spaces technology. Is a significant way to address this need of more spectrum availability by reusing some spectrum that is currently not fully utilized. So what we'll be dealing a little bit just with spectrum allocation, because I know that this is an issue that some of you are very familiar with, but there are other people that might not be really up to date with the technology of what is spectrum. And then we'll deal a little bit with TV white spaces standards and what the telecommunication and ICT4D lab of the International Center for Theoretical Physics has been doing in the last few years to try to push the adoption of this technology. And so we will mention briefly some deployment in which we collaborated in Malawi and in Mozambique. Okay, first of all, just a very quick historical view of how the spectrum has to be managed. Spectrum is something that is completely, is a commons by definition, okay? And as a common, is suffered from the tragedy of the commons, okay? So somehow must be managed. Despite that it's freely available, but the problem is that as soon as we start using it, the next user or the next person who tries to use it must somehow deal with the incumbents, with the ones that are already using the spectrum. So traditionally, this has been a task that was undertaken by government, and I think in 1914, there was a conference from a representative from all nations. They agreed on some basic rules on how to manage the spectrum and to promote also interoperability. Because at the beginning, every radio manufacturer had their own standard and their own equipment. And for instance, an equipment made by the Marconi Corporation in UK would not talk with an equipment done in Germany or in any other country. And this proved fatal when there was the tragedy of the Titanic. The radio operator of the Titanic was sending messages, and there were some ships nearby that could have helped saving a lot of lives, but they were operating in a different radio type, so they couldn't listen to the SOS signal from the Titanic. Okay, so this was what sparked the need to have a convention of nations that came together and founded the antecessor of what is today the International Telecommunication Union, which is the oldest agency of the United Nations for cooperation in matters of spectrum allocation and spectrum regulations in general. So the traditional way to allocate spectrum is by means of a decision by the government to allocate certain bands to military application, other bands to TV broadcasting, radio broadcasting, short wave or long wave, and then it came the point-to-point communication, the service of the air industry, and then satellites and so on. But they were bands that were allocated to a specific service and in specific region. The world was divided in three regions, and in each of them there were particular ways to allocate the frequency band for different services. Some people decided that there should be a better way, because there were vast, or there are still actually vast tracts of the spectrum that are underutilized. So some people decided that a free market or a market approach to the spectrum allocation would be more efficient. So they pushed to do a spectrum allocation based on action. Like, you know, that when people try to buy a piece of art, for instance, and the different would-be buyers offer prices increasing for the right to obtain that object. Okay? In this case, the object is a chunk of frequencies that can be used for some application. So some people are very they argue that this is the best way because they let the market decide who is going to use that spectrum, and supposedly the spectrum has to be used, of course, to provide communication services of one kind or another. The problem with this approach is that sometimes corporations with the big pockets, they acquire the spectrum not to use it, but just to prevent other people from using it. Okay? So this is the main drawback of this kind of approach, because if you let the market decide, the market decides only in terms of economic benefits and not in terms of social benefits. So there were a third group of people who said, okay, forget about the market, forget about the government, let's build a commission in the country that will examine the proposition of every would-be service provider, that they have to present a plan on how they are going to use the spectrum, in which conditions for the customer, in which conditions for the government, and the one who presents a plan that is best suited to the interest of the country, taking into account social interests, maybe more than economic benefits, this one will be awarded the spectrum. And of course, this in paper is again very, very good, and you know, it's almost ideal. The only problem is that the manning, or womaning, how do you say that nowadays, the decision on who is going to be in the commission and the members of this commission are human beings. And so they are subject to pressure, not always in the best intention or with the best results. So there are concerns that the decision is not always taken for the benefit of the whole population, but sometimes it can be, you know, steal into the interest of any particular group. So there is no, at the end of the day, there is no way. Now this system is called the beauty contest because it's similar to a beauty pageant in which the juror decides which one is the most handsome girl in the group. Anyway, we see that all of these systems have drawbacks, and what seems to be the best way to allocate spectrum is a dynamic spectrum allocation. Dynamic spectrum allocation is a mix in which the spectrum is not allocated to a specific user, but whoever needs the spectrum in a particular region at a particular time will have to find out what kind of spectrum is available right there, because it has been measured many, many times, and in every region about, you know, perhaps up to 50% of the spectrum is unoccupied in a given moment. The problem is how to make use of that spectrum without causing interference, without causing inconvenience to the people who have been using that frequency in that region. Okay? Even if in the particular moment they are not using it, they claim the ownership of that spectrum, so they don't welcome any newcomer into that into their turf. Okay? So what has to be done? Well, we need to have a system that is able to determine if, or rather which part of the spectrum is available at a particular time in a particular spot. And essentially, there are two schools of thought about this. One is to do a sensing of the spectrum, a device that will be able to monitor the spectrum, measure how much energy in every frequency band that can possibly be used, and when it determines a certain region in which there is silence, then go ahead and configure the radio to transmit into this particular frequency chunk. This is very, from the technological viewpoint, is probably the best situation possible, but there are some limitations. One of the limitations is that the spectrum changes with time. So if I determine that the spectrum is free in this very moment, maybe after 30 seconds, it's no longer free. So I have to be constantly monitoring the spectrum, and I have to be constantly moving from one region to the spectrum to another if the incumbent comes alive. So, this can be solved by technical means, but we are still not there. We still have limitations about using really spectrum sensing in a very efficient manner. The second problem is that in order to measure the spectrum, we need to have sophisticated spectrum analyzer or detector of some kind, and they must be able to measure the spectrum at a very, very low level to make sure that the normal users, for instance, of the TV broadcasting, are not hampered by a third party transmitting in that area. Okay? So, for instance, the FCC in the United States established that to make sure that nobody is really receiving TV channels in a given place, they require that the receiver sensitivity tone employed to do the measurement must be of -114 dBm. Okay? So this is a very, very tiny amount of power, and therefore it's very complicated because it's below the noise floor in a given place. So this is the second factor that has precluded the use of spectrum sensing as a way to control access to spectrum. The second method is the method of the, by the way, this photo were just to exemplify how controlled the spectrum is. The first one is a picture I took in Jakarta. The one in the bottom is taken in Jakarta. We were doing a wireless training at the University of Jakarta, and we happened to see the police, the spectrum police at work, taking measurements, you know, with this horn antenna and the spectrum analyzer inside the vehicle, which is quite interesting. And the one in the top, I was also doing a training activity in Uruguay, and this is a vehicle which is equipped with different kind of antenna and even a mast that can be raised in order to listen to signals high above the road, and it's again used for the same purpose. So I use this in a guide to the spectrum usage that is for APC, and you can find in the APC site there. Okay, so we already mentioned the first method to determine the spectrum availability by means of spectrum sensing or measuring the received signal. And the second method is using a geolocation database. The geolocation database must be managed by some kind of entity that can be the government or can be a third party, but this entity must have information of everything, specifically in the case of TV broadcasting spectrum. They must have information about all the stations with their power output, with their antenna directional pattern, the radiation pattern of the antennas, the power output, the height of the transmitting antenna above the ground, and of course the coordinates where they are located. And out of this information, by using a simulation of the propagation of those waves, similar to the one we saw in the past weeks, using models like the Longview Rise model or other models, they can build a map of what is going to be the power of these signals in any region of interest. Of course, since these are made through simulations, they are prone to error. They are not 100% accurate, because the simulation might not take into consideration many of the factors that affect the received power intensity. So normally people err, on the trying to be conservative, and they decide that the places in which other devices might operate without interfering with the TV signals are very, very restricted and very much constrained to safeguard the interest of the TV broadcasting stations. Have any questions? Okay, so because of the limitation of the spectrum sensing, both the FCC in the United States and the Ofcom in the United Kingdom have adopted the database as the best approach to allow TV waste-based devices from third party to use the TV spectrum, the spectrum that was allocated to TV broadcasting. And keep in mind that the spectrum allocated to TV broadcasting was done many, many decades ago, when TV was the most important usage of the spectrum. This is not so nowadays. Nowadays, TV is just a tiny fraction, and the most important users of spectrum are the cellular companies, and of course, government, and many other organizations. And so, despite the fact the TV broadcasting have resisted any effort to try to relinquish some of their spectrum they have been allocated, because this is their economic interest to keep use of it. Or actually to keep ownership of it, because very often they don't use it, but they don't want anybody else to use it either. So, in both cases, in order to take advantage and to comply with the regulation, rather, you need to have a cognitive radio. A cognitive radio is a device that either sends the environment with the spectrum analyzer, or is able to communicate with the database to find out what frequencies are allowable to use in a particular place. So, for the second case, it needs to have a very accurate positioning information, must have a GPS or some other means of determining its position, and it also needs to have a method to query the database to find, send the information on where it is located, and ask the database, what frequency can I use in this particular spot at this very moment? Then this database automatically, of course, there's not a person involved, it's just the machine-to-machine interaction. The database will return with a list of channels and maximum power allowed in that particular moment. And this should be done very frequently in case somebody, some of the incumbents decide to start transmitting in the channel that was previously vacant. So, this is a cumbersome process which increases significantly the price of the equipment, because it means that for any TV white spaces database to comply with this requirement, it must have a GPS, which nowadays is not a big issue, but it must have some means to query the database before making use of the TV white spectrum. So it must have some other means of communicating with the database, either by cable or by other frequency band. And this means that it must have at least two radios, one for TV white spaces and another one to get to the internet to communicate with the database. And of course this means that the cost of the base station increase, the cost and the complexity increases notably. Okay, so just a very quick review of, you know, if you have an analog TV system, in a given city you might be using channel 10, which goes, this is an example, just goes to 192 megahertz to 198 megahertz, and then you can be using channel 12, which goes from 204 to 210 megahertz. But you cannot possibly use channel 11 in this example because the analog spectrum spreads in the adjacent channel. So if you try to use channel 11, you'll get a lot of interference. So for a technical reason, there must be always a white space between channel 10 and channel 12. Okay? In a neighboring city, you might have a different situation. You might be using channel 11 and channel 13, but you must always leave a white space in between the channels to avoid interference. So this can be used using modern technology. These white spaces can be used to provide other kinds of services, like the internet access that we all crave for.
So,
okay, so just some of the things I put here I forgot to mention before. There is a very strong growing demand for spectrum, because we, you know, communication is a very, very deep human need, and so people need to communicate. Even people who have a very low income, they devote a large portion of their income to be able to communicate. Okay? And there is plenty of spectrum allocated to TV broadcasting, especially in the developing country, most of the spectrum is not being used because there is no economic benefit for a broadcaster to use many channels in a rural area. Instead, they devote their effort to cover the cities. The cities normally have plenty of TV channels to choose from, but the countryside very often is idle, the spectrum is idle in the countryside. So this is an opportunity for what is called spectrum refarming, using the spectrum to another purpose. And there are many efforts in building standards for making this easier. And there are regulations in place in a few countries, and the other are coming very soon. I don't have the latest. I think Ghana was going to put up some regulation, and South Africa and some other countries. I think even Kenya has some, at least some kind of regulation. Okay, so the definition of TV white spaces is the first one we already mentioned, okay? Spectrum that was allocated, not currently being used. The spectrum left free between two analogous TV channels. And also, when countries undergo the transition from analog TV to digital TV, digital TV is much more spectrum efficient than analog TV. So there is no longer the problem of the signal leaking into adjacent channels. The channels, the intervening channels are no longer needed or do not need to be kept free because the digital signal is confined precisely to the spectrum assigned. And besides, you can pack many TV channels in what was the spectrum occupied by a single analog channel. So this has made that all the countries that have transitioned from analog TV to digital TV have now what is called the benefit of the transition, the digital benefit, because of the efficiency of the digital technology. Now there is more spectrum available, but the spectrum has not been made available for two-way communication, which is what we would like to do, but rather has been kept by the same TV transmitter owners. Okay, so this is a quick glance of some of the standards for the leveraging of TV white spaces. The most important is perhaps the IEEE 802.22, which is specifically meant for long distance and rural areas, and the 802.11AF, which is for shorter distances, but it's also very well known because it's based on the same technology as Wi-Fi based, just in a different frequency band. And well, there are others, but I am not going to bore you with that, just the technical details. So what is important to keep in mind is that there are big advantages of using the TV white space spectrum as regard to, for instance, Wi-Fi. We have here a graph that shows the propagation loss versus distance for ideal conditions. In practice, there might be other factors. Okay? But in the free space, if there are no obstruction, no absorption, no hills, no trees, if you compare the range of a Wi-Fi signal with that of the TV white spaces, you will find that the TV white spaces can have a much bigger range because the free space loss is lower. Okay? The second advantage is the fact that the attenuation of the signals by foliage and by the walls of any building is much stronger at the higher frequency than at the frequencies of the TV white spaces. And the third one is the fact that TV white spaces can go beyond the line of sight. This morning we saw the presentation by Richard, which was showing a transmitter and the receiver beyond a hill that was blocking completely the line of sight. And this is an example that this can easily be done with TV white spaces, but it cannot be done with Wi-Fi or other higher frequency technology. Okay, these are some of the Dynamic Spectrum Alliance, some pilots, and some commercial deployment in several places. And now I'll talk a little bit about the Telecommunication and ICT for Development Lab in the International Center for Theoretical Physics. We strive to help people get connected in order to enhance the productivity, including the scientific productivity. And for that purpose, we focus on three activities: training, deployment, and research. Because we think that the three activities must be done to reinforce each other and to do the job in the best possible way. This is an example of the spectrum here in Nairobi that was collected the 21 of this month. And you can see here that the red areas correspond of heavy spectrum usage. So you can see that there are stripes, horizontal red stripes, that correspond to a very high spectrum usage. But there are in between some areas like this one that is free, this one that is free, this one, and all this is completely free. And this is in downtown Nairobi. So, we have developed a system to help spectrum advocacy all over the world by using a low-cost spectrum analyzer that Carlos will show afterwards. And so you will be, so I cannot, I will not use my time to demonstrate it. And a whole system to help advocacy efforts in countries, so to convince the local regulator that there is plenty of spectrum that has been not used and that should be leveraged to provide much needed two-way access to the internet. So this is an example of a bus ride we did last Sunday from the hotel to Quivera. And you can see here that while we were near town, the spectrum was quite occupied. But as we reached Quivera, the spectrum fell down. This graph is a percentage of places or samples that were below minus 85 dBm. So it shows that heavy utilization of the spectrum here, over 75%, but around here, the utilization of the spectrum is very little. And so this platform can be used by anyone, only needs to buy a RF spectrum analyzer, and and then with any Android phone and special cable called an OTG cable, you can record the spectrum.
So this is the RF Explorer. Actually, it comes with different frequency ranges. This actually, I got it, is called 6G combo, because I'm not only measuring wide spaces, I'm also measuring GSM wide spaces. We can talk about it later. But it's literally what the man was saying. This is an OTG cable from mini USB to micro USB, an RF Explorer that is capturing that, and that information also. The ICP has actually done this tool. So by the apps that they have developed, you can install it in your phone, and it goes straight away into the database, and it can be visualized and so on to everyone. Actually, tomorrow when we go to Quivera, we will do exactly the same map, but for GSM. Yesterday, 2 days ago, I was measuring GSM here, and there is bands that are in the middle of my road. We're not talking about GSM, not about people.
Thank you, Carol. Okay, so let's go to the nitty-gritty of the thing. We don't only did the visualization, the advocacy, but we also tried to convince regulators about the benefit that the population would reap if they allow the installation of this kind of technology. So in Malawi, we had good friends at the University of Malawi who were able to talk to the local regulator and convince the local regulator to give us a temporary permit to do an installation there. So MACRA gave us this document that allowed us to do the deployment in Malawi. And the deployment was done in near Somba, in between Somba and Blantyre, where the university has a tower that houses a TV transmitter. So we took advantage of that tower to put a big antenna for TV wide spaces, the base station there, and we were giving service to several communities nearby. The longest one was a hospital, 19 kilometers away. This is the antenna. You can see that the antenna is quite big and heavy, because this is a very performant antenna. It can work from 470 to 790 megahertz with a flat gain of 6 dBi. So this is why it's so big. You can get smaller antenna, cheaper antenna, if you restrict your frequency of operation to a smaller band, not the whole TV wide spaces band, but a restricted band. That way you can save some money and effort. This is an example of a receiving antenna. This is in the St. Mary's School. And we have here an example of a Yagi antenna used for the CPE. And you can see that it's quite big also. And this is the CPE radio we use in that deployment after TV White Spaces training program that was held at the University of Malawi. Okay, then a year later, or 2 years later actually, we were invited by the Mozambique regulatory body, the Instituto Nacional das Comunicações do Mozambique, to do a similar project in Mozambique. Again, we had previously done spectrum measurement, so the government was, or the regulatory was happy that there were big region of the space that were not, of the spectrum that were not used, so they gave us the authorization, and in this case, we set up a base station that was to give near Maputo, the capital, and but not so near, I mean, in the suburb, in the Matola region, and there we were providing services to a primary school, to a secondary school, and to a community center, just as a pilot. The pilot was quite successful, and actually they invited us to do another one, a phase two of this project that is still, you know, in the works. But this is an example of a different kind of base station antenna. You can see that this antenna is much smaller than the one shown in the previous picture, because this is still wideband, but this is a sectorial antenna. So the previous antenna was an omnidirectional antenna that served the whole region around it with the same amount of electric field, whereas this one is a sectorial antenna which has a service area of about 120 degrees, something like that. So if you want to cover the 360 degrees, you would need three of these antennas, okay? But they are of a smaller size. And again, the CPE is also, this is not the Yagi, this is a log periodic, but again, it's big. Okay, so I try to stick to my time, and I reach the conclusions of my talk. I'd be happy to try to answer some questions. I don't know if I'm allowed to do that now or later on. That's up to Carlos. Anyway, I just want to emphasize that TV White Spaces is an opportunity, and I think that Richard this morning gave a brilliant presentation on how this opportunity can be reaped, because we need pilots. But pilots are just, you know, spearheading the technology. We are not the commercial provider. And despite some criticism about commercial provider, I think that commercial providers that have also a strong sense of social responsibility, like Richard was saying, they have. I don't know if it's true. Like we just talk, you know. But anyway, I think that in this case, they are working hand-in-hand with the government, and this seems to be a very big project. And so I hope that this kind of example is taken in other parts of, in other countries of Africa and elsewhere. And so the regulatory approval is the main requirement. So this is why we think that spectrum advocacy by means of spectrum measurement is a tool that can be used to convince the regulator to give approval for this, for the leveraging of these frequencies. And another final thought is that there hasn't been that many deployments of White Spaces for a reason that I attribute to the fact that in developing countries, there are first of all, the spectrum is already quite crowded. And second, there are already in place many alternatives to internet access, so they don't feel the need for the TV White Spaces technology, which, on the other hand, is very, very much suited for the need of rural areas in developing countries. So I think this is an opportunity for developing countries to leapfrog as they did, many of them, with the cellular technology, with the payment using telecommunication system like M-Pesa here in Kenya, which has been heralded like a first worldwide. I think there is another opportunity for a developing country to show the rest of the world a new way of leveraging these frequencies that are currently being underutilized. Okay, thank you very much.
And thank you very much to you.